Good morning, church. It is the fourth Sunday of Advent. That means that we will be changing between the Advent season and the Christmas season this week. Since that transition actually happens on Thursday night, 6 o'clock, that is traditionally in the calendar when we celebrate the changing of the tide between Advent and Christmas on Christmas Eve. We call it Christmas Tide. I love that name. We're going to be actually doing that a little bit early and starting to anticipate even more so the coming of Jesus as we walk through this story of his life. Our text this week is a non-traditional Christmas text, but I think a good one. It comes from the final verses of the book of Romans, Romans chapter 16. This is where Paul, as he is prone to do, lapses into doxology, which is just a word for praise. And so when we sing that song doxology, praise God from whom all blessings flow, that is just a song of praise. This is where he lapses into doxology and prayer. And so we begin in Romans chapter 16, verse 25. May the glory be to God who can strengthen you with my good news and the message that I preached about Jesus Christ. He can strengthen you with the announcement of the secret. Your translation may say the mystery that was kept quiet for a long time. Now that secret is revealed through what the prophets wrote. It is made known to the Gentiles in order to lead to their faithful obedience based on the command of the eternal God. May the glory be to God who alone is wise. May the glory be to him through Jesus Christ forever. Amen. So for just a few minutes this morning, I want to talk about this secret, this mystery that Paul is talking about here. It plays such a central role in his doxology at the end of Romans. And if you were to expand your horizons to the rest of Paul's writing, it plays a central role in a lot of his writings. He talks about it in Colossians. He talks about it at a couple of crucial points in the book of Ephesians, for instance. This is a major theme for Paul. And so we come to the mystery. And at the end of Romans 16, this mystery is equated with the gospel, the good news that Paul preached. And so the mystery of God is revealed, Paul says, in the gospel. But what do we mean by gospel? Or perhaps a better question for us this morning is, what does Paul mean by gospel? And what does the rest of the New Testament mean by gospel? And fortunately, they answer that question for us. Paul opens his letter to the Romans by talking about that gospel. He gives us a summary, and the summary of that essentially is that through the life and the death and the burial and the resurrection and the ascension of Jesus, he has now been declared king over all of the cosmos. That is, for Paul, what the gospel is. He says a very similar thing at the end of 1 Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 15, the opening chapter. He says, I need to remind you of some of the most basic things that you have learned from me. This is the gospel, that Jesus was crucified according to scripture, that he was buried, that he was resurrected, that he was witnessed to in the resurrection, that he ascended. And so Paul has in mind, when he talks about the gospel, this movement of Jesus' life culminating in his death and his resurrection and his ascension, through which he is named the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And of course, this is, more broadly speaking, the story the Gospels are telling as well, that in Jesus, God has now established his kingdom. He is the Christ. That is a royal term. That is a term for kings. He is the Son of God. And when Jesus came into the world, that was not a term for the second person of the Godhead, although later we would kind of nuance it with that meaning. When he was born, to call somebody the Son of God was to say that they were a king, that they had authority, that they were royal. He was declared by God in Acts chapter 2, among other places, to be the Lord, which was, of course, Caesar's term. And the Lord is the one who is in charge, the one where the buck stops. This is the one who is the head over all things. And so he is the Christ. He is the Son of God. He is the Lord. And we declare his gospel, which is, after all, in Jesus' day, not a particularly religious term, but a military term, a political term to talk about a victory won over an enemy, and through that victory, a new reign or a new rule or a new king has begun to hold authority. And so the gospel story, we want to be very clear, is not first and foremost about us. It's not first and foremost about what decision we will make or what eternal value that decision will have for good or for ill or anything like that. The gospel is first and foremost the proclamation that Jesus is king. That God has in Jesus Christ come into the world and he has defeated the dark powers that hold sway over the brokenness of our world. And now he is king. And so in a sense, what I want you to think about this morning is the revealing of the mystery that Paul praises God for here at the end of Romans in chapter 16. The revealing of the mystery is God answering some of the most fundamental cries that we cry out in the midst of that darkness. We look at our broken world oftentimes and we say, why are things the way they are? Why does it seem that bad people have sway in the world? Why does it seem that good people, even in their best attempts, end up being inept or messing things up or falling short of the goal? Why does it seem that for all of our best intentions, we never seem to arrive at a sort of world that is just or peaceful or good or flourishing? Why do good people suffer? And these questions could go on and on. And throughout history, we have always cried out these questions. We see them in the Bible, in places like Job, in places like the Psalms, in places like the prophets. I think particularly this morning of Habakkuk as he cries out to the Lord in the midst of the injustice of Judah. Lord, how long will you let this go on? And so for all of history, these questions have been coming up out of the darkness. How long? Why is it this way? Why do they get away with it? Why do we keep messing things up? Can't we do something better than this? And the way the New Testament presents Jesus, I want you to see this morning, is that Jesus is God's answer to those things. Jesus is God's answer to that cry that rises out of the midst of the darkness over the brokenness of the world. That is the revelation of the mystery. Jesus is, as one of my preachers, Brian Zond, loves to say, Jesus is what God has to say. And there's a text, as I was thinking about the end of Romans 16, that I kept coming back to. It's a text that you're familiar with. We have probably talked about it before, but I want to think about it for just a few minutes this morning. It is about halfway through John chapter 1. It's actually at the end of John's kind of introductory segment to his gospel. John, of course, begins in verse 1 by talking about how the Word was in the beginning. It was with God. The Word was God, and everything that was created was by the Word. And it talks a little further down about how the Word becomes flesh. And the Word dwelt among us, bringing light and life into the world. But then we come down to verse 18, and he has this final thing to say about the Word. He says, first, no one at any time has ever seen God. No one at any time has ever seen God, he says. And that's an interesting statement when you sit down and think about it, because all of us who have been going to church for any length of time, we've read our Bibles growing up, we went to Sunday school, we learned the lessons, and we know that plenty of people in the Old Testament have seen God. It wasn't too long ago in our Sunday morning class when we were doing things like having Sunday morning classes where, Moses is up on Mount Sinai and he gets to see God as he passes by. God puts him back in the cranny of a rock and he starts to walk past him and he covers his eyes with his hand as he walks past. But as he goes by so you can't see his face anymore, he pulls his hands away and Moses sees God walking past. We think about Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 6. I think about Ezekiel and his vision of the chariot, the will within the will. Cue that song, the will in the sky keeps on turning or burning. We think about Daniel appearing before the throne room of God and the dream that he has in Daniel chapter 7. Plenty of people have seen God. What do you mean when you say no one has ever seen God? And I think that what we are talking about when we're talking about the revelation of this mystery, and how this ties together, you'll see it in just a minute. But we're talking about the revelation of this mystery. We're not talking about some sort of thing that no one knew anything about, that no one had any clue about leading up to the revelation of Jesus Christ as what God has to say. But the mystery was such that all sorts of people knew all sorts of things about God. He had revealed all sorts of things about himself. He had interacted with them in history. People knew God to a certain extent. But I think what's going on is that at the end of the Old Testament period, the time that John is sitting here writing his gospel, talking about when Jesus came to earth, I think for all that they knew about God, they didn't know God as clearly as they wanted to know God. They still had questions, not least of those, these questions that were going up out of the darkness. This is what was going on in Luke chapter 1 as they gathered around the temple to pray when the angel appeared to Zechariah. They were calling on God to keep his promises. Why haven't you kept your promises? And so for all they knew about God, there were still these lingering questions. They did not see God as clearly as they wanted to see God. And I would wager that they did not see God as clearly as God wanted to be seen. And so there were a lot of things left hanging. There were a lot of things left focused. There was still this secret. They had a lot of pieces, but the puzzle wasn't quite coming together. And so John says at the end of his introduction in John 1 verse 18, he says, "No one at any time has ever seen God. We do not see God as clearly as we want to see God. We do not see God, we do not comprehend God as fully as we want to comprehend God. And we do not see God as clearly as God wants to be seen." But then he says, "But the only begotten God who is at the side of the Father," that is some very flowery, typically John language for saying, but Jesus explains God. And it's Christmas time, and I'm sitting next to my Christmas tree because it's like the only corner in the house where I can get decent light when I'm using this setup. So I got the Christmas tree in view here. And Christmas is actually an apt time to talk about Jesus explaining God, because the word in Greek there is a word that literally means something like Jesus unwraps God. And I remember when I was a kid, and I've probably told you this story before. I remember when I was a kid, they would start putting presents under the tree. As soon as Thanksgiving was over, we put the tree up on Black Friday and presents would start going out soon after. And there was always a stern warning: if you mess with the presents, they're going back, so leave them alone. But I think the statute of limitations is up now. I confess that when mom and dad were not around or mom and dad were not looking, I would always go in and I would try to figure out what those presents were. They were wrapped. I never went as far as trying to unwrap them and rewrap them, but I would pick them up. I would kind of gauge their weight and the density of the package. I would shake it to see if it had any sort of rattle to it, any sort of movement in there. I'd sniff it to make sure it wasn't something like fruitcake. And by the time Christmas Day rolled around, I kind of knew a lot of things about that gift. I knew about what shape it was and the possibilities that that shape might imply and the density of it. And if it had a little squish to it, it might be a video game. If it had no squish to it, it might be a book and things like that. But until they plopped that thing down in my lap on Christmas morning, I could tear that paper off. That mystery for all the things I knew about the gift had not been revealed. And John chapter 1 says that Jesus unwraps, he reveals God. He shows us what God looks like. One more time, as Brian Zahn says, Jesus is what God has to say. And so Christmas marks the beginning of this revelation. Christmas marks the beginning. We're going to talk about Christmas for the next few weeks, because Christmas is not a day. Christmas is a season. That's why we sing the 12 days of Christmas. Starts on Christmas Day, goes for 12 days. As we talk about God coming into the world in the form of Jesus Christ over the next few weeks, I want you to swim in this notion, to let your mind work on this notion that Jesus is what God looks like. Think about Hebrews chapter 1. In the past, God has demonstrated himself, revealed himself in various ways through prophets and writings and other things. But now, in these last times, he has shown us who he is through his Son. Jesus is the one who represents God. Think about Colossians 1. He is the image of the invisible God, firstborn of all creation. And all that implies, Jesus is what God looks like. And so one of the reasons why we celebrate Christmas is because on the hills of Advent, where we've been living in the darkness, living in anticipation, living in the longing for something more, now finally, gloriously, fully. God has shown his hand, has revealed himself, has said, this is what I'm up to. I've been hearing your cry all along. I'm answering your cry. And that answer looks like Jesus Christ. And so think about that this week. Pray about that. Ponder what it means. Think about how it shapes how we look like God. And maybe, just maybe, find yourself in doxology and praise like Paul, that the mystery has been revealed as we turn the tide from that longing in the darkness to the joy of the revelation of God in Jesus Christ. All right, so I'm going to pray for you, and then I'm going to ask you to pray with me, and then we will, I think, have time to completely and fully do this right and remember who we are. Let's pray. God, we give you praise for revealing to us Jesus Christ, our Lord. We thank you for the work that you are doing in the kingdom with bringing hope to those who have no hope and bringing joy to those who mourn and bringing satisfaction to those who long for something better than what this world has to offer. We give you all praise for who you have shown yourself to be in Jesus Christ. And I ask for the courage and the wisdom for myself and our church family to follow you into the world as people who reflect that glory, as faithful bearers of that secret revealed. Father, we now come to you and we pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory now and forever. Amen. We shall love the Lord our God with all our heart and with all our soul, with all our mind and with all our strength. This is the first and greatest commandment, and a second commandment is like it. We shall love our neighbor as ourselves. All of the law and the prophets hang on these two commands. We love because God first loved us. Anyone who says that they love God but hates their brother or sister is a liar. How are you going to love God whom you have never seen if you don't love your brother or sister who is right in front of you? So this is the command we have from him. Those who love God must also love their brother and sister. Church, we love you and we miss you. We hope that you have a wonderful opening of this Christmas season. We will see you again soon. Have a great week.